I'm going to geeze on you today a little bit, but hopefully you'll see some interesting pictures and interesting stories, and I'll talk a bit about what I think the past, present, and future are of technology and teaching. But let me give you what I think the bottom line is. This was a really interesting assignment. Thank you, Naomi and everybody else who got me this, because I started thinking more about technology and teaching, and I realized there's at least two ways to look at teaching. The way I looked at it was kind of simplistic. I think it still is. And that's helping people learn. That sounds very noble, right? Easy. Helping people learn. I think it's more. I think the burden for us is to help people discover why they should learn, what they should learn, or at least begin that process, and teach them how to learn so they can do it on their own. And we could talk about that for a whole course, I think. And my colleagues and Seth, I apologize to you for presenting this so blithely. But here's the other thing. This is probably the important thing today that I can tell you. I think there's two ways of looking at using technology in teaching. One is the method of teaching. And the method I got, and I'll talk more about this in a minute, was the one I was trained in, so it must be the best, is the SOTS method. Sage on the stage. SOTS. So you're familiar with this, I'm sure. But just if you haven't heard it, it's an interesting idea. And I think the other method that we've been working on a lot is the GOTS method. And we've been moving towards the guide on the side method. And a lot of what you're learning about, we're teaching each other about, is the latter. But that's the method. And there's a lot of different methods of teaching. Those are just general families of it. The other way that technology is usually used, and that's what I first thought of, is the hardware, the software. And this can be a lot of different things. It's sort of like a delivery system. Like right now, and a minute ago, I was using a fork delivery system. But it's just the delivery system. You can have a high-tech fork. You can have a silver or golden spoon. You could have a sieve that doesn't work so well. But the stuff you're teaching, that's the method of teaching. That's the SOTS or the GOTS, the stuff you're eating that's giving you what you want. So that's that distinction that I could belabor. It's always fun to make distinctions like that, isn't it? So I think I had already done SOTS versus GOTS. Yes, I did that. Another thing that I want to say, I want to confess that SOTS is a lot more fun because we're in control, right? Yes, because we know what's best. It encourages learning by lecture, which is ironically what we're doing right now, sort of. Sorry. The guide on the side puts the student much more in control, and I think it empowers asynchronous learning, learning whenever, however, whatever, whoever. Very different, but I think that's at least where I see myself moving. And the thing that the inspiration that I got when I started preparing for this thing was technology can empower GOTS, not just SOTS. And I think that's particularly useful. I used to lecture using lecture notes for a computer, and then somebody said, your notes are yellow. So I decided, oh, okay, I'll put them on a computer and use that as word processing. I'll show you some of my early word processors. Some of you have not seen these ever before. So I had nice, clean notes, but it was the same SOTS approach to things. I ended up putting my lectures and videos and all the rest online. That was great. Blackboard was easy to use for that. And I found myself moving to, OL is online. Sorry, you probably knew that. I wanted to avoid getting papers from students that were smelly. They reeked of tobacco all the time, and I'd stopped smoking, so I didn't want to smell that anymore. And they were full of cold germs, I'm sure, because everyone was sneezing into their typewriters or whatever it was. And I haven't shown any pictures yet. And they'd always put them in these slippery binders, you know, and you'd take them to class and they'd slip all around on the quad. And so having people upload papers made a lot more sense. It made my life easier, and that was what is important. I thought it might help the students too, but I confess that was kind of secondary. And then I thought, you know, you could put the exams online because these athletes, wonderful people, work for us. They got like games and stuff, and sometimes they're not here, they're elsewhere. And a lot of people's grandparents experience high rates of mortality and morbidity. And so, I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. I'm about to be one of those myself. But they do. And And if I could just let them take the exams more or less on their own, any place, any time, that would be great. So Blackboard helped me do that. So it made my life lots easier. The result, as soon as I put slides online on the rest, is I accidentally flipped my classroom. I found students going online, listening to the lectures there, not listening to me in class. But that was a time to really work on papers and solve problems, right? So out of 40 people, 3 or 5 showed up, but it was fine. It worked out fine. I'll show you the paper, the pictures in a minute. It'll be a lot better. I got some validation of this approach, though, in my summer teaching that Jim Lee and others in the center encouraged, so I guess it's probably all right. Now I'm in my second year of teaching entirely GOTSI courses, at least online. And let me talk a bit about it, the past. And I got the present and future if there's enough time, but maybe not. So where it all began for me was in front of my dad's books. And I was very frightened when he took this picture because I thought, oh my gosh, here's technology books. It is a technology. It's a one-to-many system. It's asynchronous. It's fairly cost-effective, although, as Naomi's mentioned, we're working on the cost part of that. And I was worried, but he was thankful that I was worshiping at the altar of book tech, so that was good. Delivery system, I've used a few of these in terms of technology of teaching. One, the teletype. It's not just a way of getting news. It's a way of actually writing programs. Yes. How many people here wrote basic programs on a teletype? Yes. I have a picture that's going to make you cry in a minute. You know, old times, ADM terminals. What really got me going was a delivery system and a method. The delivery system was paper, little manuals, and you'd read this, and then you'd read the thing, and then you'd take a quick test on the reading, and you would advance through a color system, kind of like karate belts, but it was purple, silver, gold. Some of you probably know the system. It was inspiring. I still think of that when I think of how could I use technology to inspire self-paced teaching. That was in fourth grade. That was so much fun. And then there's, in terms of methods of teaching, those of you who've studied and then abandoned Skinner will recognize Holland and Skinner's analysis of behavior book was actually a teaching method, a teaching machine, but instead just a book. You read a little strip, and then it would guide you to another page and get crazy. But you would learn at your own pace. And you'd be tested on every little bite-sized nugget of wisdom. So I tried to incorporate that into my teaching. This is just to geese you if they deign to show that. Now there's the storage system is right here. Here's your punch paper tape. Really. And it would go ka-chunk, ka-chunk, and then there is your printout. And if you were writing a novel, you could just sit there and watch the whole novel go out. Here's the blue mini terminal. Saying, ah, and then punch cards, of course. I brought those here. So I started there, here's the other. Here's the mobile technology I brought at the time. It wouldn't be a Jack Child presentation if there wasn't an artifact. He always brought artifacts. So this is a slide rule. It's a log system. This is really good, too. It's ivory. So it's constant, and it's not affected by temperature. All right. Tape to disk storage. I remember I was so impressed when we went from the audio tape to the disk storage. It was so fast. I was carrying around this stuff. I'll show you some more pictures of it. And Jack Child would often say, Brian, get a mule. Because I was carrying around this TV and this. Well, I'll show you some pictures here. So I'll start with some of you remember the Trash 80, the Tandy Radio Shack Model 180. And the computer's in the keyboard. The screen is a TV with the tuner ripped out. It's a black and white TV. And the storage device is an audio tape recorder. You put in the magnetic tape, I think it's called. And it's portable because you can put it in a suitcase, pretty much. But when you add the interface, I remember boosting it from 4 to 8K. You know, they had silver contacts rather than gold, and as you know, silver does tend to corrode. So the thing would crash due to hardware, not just software, which this may do just to remind me. To geese a little more, the old K-Pro 2, of course, which was also portable because it had a handle. It would fit just under the airline seats before they put all that junk under there. And then when my back went out, which it did, I used that as a rationale to buy a more portable MS-DOS computer. All right, a little bit about present. I have a few more minutes. Of course, at present, I'm using stuff that seems very modern. There, the MacBook Pro and the iPad. And you know what? This stuff will be viewed as archaic, as what you just saw with the teletypes. Who knows what it's going to be? But really, things are moving faster, not slower, I think. Students have not changed. They're all the same. They're great. They're amazing. They're enthusiastic. There's some honor students here. And when I said living the dream, there was a slight tint of irony there, but not too much. It's really been pretty good. I love the idea. I feel very freed by the idea that I can teach pretty much anywhere, anytime, any place. And I suppose to anyone. I got 90,000 people registered for my health psych course if they would just do the readings. And I got to confess, as I think I indicated, I went purely SOTS. I just, you know, techno-chromed it. And what I had was just as good as other stuff you might chrome. But instead, I think this technology is enabling me to be more guide on this side and to feel good about it and to see the advantages of it. It also gives me the opportunity to spend a whole afternoon working on my lecture and presenting it, recording it, refining it, and then the evening, and then the next morning. No, it doesn't get that bad. But you can control that. But it's so nice to be able to just delve into that as opposed to you got an hour and 15 and then you're done. You can't do anything more. And that I found very discouraging. So I loved being able to have those bursts of effort in teaching and then to focus on research for another few days and to go back and forth. Because the stuff is there. And then I can refine it, unlike those lecture notes that never seem to get much better. I love the flexibility, and the students do too, of time and space, where you can go almost any place and teach. Although I always seem to go to the office. Got to work on that. Finally, I find it lets me devote more time to research and writing, and that's just amazing. The how, you probably know, and you're getting a lot of advice on that, but how I coped with the limits that are always there in any institution, except American University, I bought my own stuff. I mean, all that stuff there I bought, except the teletype. That stuff there, it's all bought. You could deduct it, right? Eventually, I got a projection pad. This is a really high-tech device. It's basically a laptop screen without the backing or the backlight. And you place it on top of there's none here. An overhead projector. Is that World War II technology, I think? Probably before then, training technology. It used to be in every classroom in the campus. I think it still is to hang coats and hats. But you could put the projection pad on it, and whatever was on your computer would be attached to the projection pad, which even then had a VGA connection, and then it would go up to the screen. I know, it's kind of hard to imagine, but it worked really well. Even had color, and I bought all that. And then the laptops, the projectors, the iPad, using rogue networks, that's what you got going here, right? Only I can't access the internet now because they clamped down that security feature and none of the Ethernet ports here work anymore, but that's all right. Being able to use Blackboard. And when they said, as I was told last semester, well, there's no space on the server for any more of your lectures, Brian. I just said, I'm going to put them all on YouTube. Doesn't cost me a thing. And my students like it better anyway, and I'll put them all on iTunes U. So I did that. They still haven't taken them down from the server, though. I got no idea why. So these are all workarounds that you're familiar with. We all have to do them different ways. And where I'm at now, 2 undergraduate courses a semester, totally online. My second year doing it, I'm also taking some out-of-print textbooks I wrote for one of the courses, self-management that incorporated student examples, their self-management projects, the better ones, and with their permission. And I put them actually in there to illustrate the different points and the applications, and now I update those, and since they're out-of-print anyway, I finally encourage the publisher not to sue me. That's what they said they'd do, not sue me if I use them. So I got them there as iBooks. I give them out free to the students. There's PDFs as well for those folks who don't want to go into the iWorld. And that's helped a lot. How am I going to end this? I got no idea. But I got 30 more seconds, so it's OK. I continue to use tech to supervise research of doctoral students. This is almost entirely online, too, because they're clinical PhD students. And you know what clinical PhD students do? They do clinical work, and they get trained for endless hours. And to get hold of them, to actually get in there for a meeting, it's very difficult. So we do phone, we do GoToMeeting. Once in a while we meet face to face, or F2F as it's called. Usually if I provide free food and beverages. So what I like and don't like about online, maybe I'll talk about that later. I think I've run out of time. So I can talk about that more when you ask the question. That's a cue, but for now, I gotta turn it over to you, Dean. Yeah, yeah. There you go.
Hello. You know, I feel like we got the order a little twisted here. You know, for many years I was in various rock bands, and so when you'd book shows, typically what would happen is you would take the more established, more prestigious individual or band or whatever, put them last, so that this would serve as an enticement to get people to pay attention to the newer upstart, less. Time-tested, road-tested act that would come first, and so following Brian will be a tough act to follow. But we'll see if we can do it. If you give me just 1 second, I'll pull up my. Yes, you can see how technologically illiterate I am because I haven't upgraded to Windows 8 yet. Okay, so theoretically this should work. Okay, so that is in there, and then here is something that I'm going to present to you. Okay, so. I intentionally made my PowerPoint presentation not too complicated because I knew I might be having to present it on a different machine than I created it on. And as many of you know, when you do that, typically many things change. And the more complicated you make your presentation, the more things are likely to change. So, also, does this laptop have internet? I really hope so. Oh, good. Well, I probably should have asked that question before I got on the stage, but I'm really glad that's the case. So I'm going to use my time. I don't know how long this is going to take. If I'm going over someone, please like wave their arms at me or something. to talk about tech tools and resources for teaching and learning. That sounds like a really generic title, but it actually has a little bit more to it than may initially meet the eye. I should talk a little bit about what I do. I'm an SOC. A lot of my research focuses on political uses of social media and digital communication technologies, and much of my research is focused on analyzing the content that is produced through these services. Long story short, that involves pulling the data out of these services, primarily Twitter and Facebook, but also others, and finding ways to analyze them at scale. And so typically, you know, one of the projects I'm working on with a couple of colleagues, we're looking at somewhere in the range of 57 million tweets about Syria over the past, well, not past, but over about 32 months. And so that's an enormous undertaking. And so on the research level, that's kind of what I do. But one of the things I'm really, really interested in is passing this information on, not only to grad students, PhD students, but also to undergrads. And I have done, I've started to do some of this stuff. I'm kind of making it up as I go, trying to learn things from other people who do this along the way. And so, again, examples of this, you know, the social media data collection, simply obtaining the data itself is a really, can be surprisingly difficult given how long Facebook and Twitter have been around. There's this idea that I keep, you know, trying to push to everyone who will listen, which is programming as a research method. If you know anything about the social sciences, you know what the typical research methods are, experiments, content analysis. On the qualitative side, you've got interviewing, ethnography, qualitative textual analysis. I believe that programming should be added to the quantitative side of this, and I'm doing everything I can to make that happen within my own field of communication. And network analysis, which has been around since the early part of the 20th century, I recently learned, but has really gotten a lot of purchase in terms of people who do social media analysis, myself included. I've become so infatuated with it that I've invented a few new tools for it. New, right? I mean, that's sort of something that I would like to think. Until someone comes along and says, well, you know, we actually been doing that for 30 years, which happens on occasion. So before we get our heads too big with that, we should do some background research. And so the other thing that's really important to note is that with my research, you know, technology is no mere add-on, it's integral, because I teach technological topics, technology is right there in the title. So this is not so much something that I can take or leave. It's something that really is essential to my teaching. And so I want to distinguish between a couple of different kinds of instructional tech that have sort of framed the way that I've thought about this. So this idea of teaching tools is a notion of technological implements that students use to create or analyze content. Some of these I've created myself, others I adopt that other folks have created, and I'll give three examples of teaching tools that are technological in nature that I've found useful and interesting. And then the second one is teaching resources, and this is where the technology is used as a source of consultation or study that students use to solidify their understanding of various concepts. And after I talk about teaching tools, I'll talk about some of the teaching resources that I have created / adopted and that I found useful for various levels of teaching. Okay, so I'm gonna go and just do some demos of this stuff. It usually drives the point home a little bit better if I show rather than tell. So I'll just go ahead and do that. Hopefully the internet will work. And as anyone who's ever done a live tech demo knows, I'm tempting fate by doing this, but we'll see how well it works. Here we go. Okay, so Naomi mentioned Recal. Recal is not just a teaching tool. It is a tool that's used by, right now it's had over 100,000 uses by researchers all over the world. It calculates several coefficients for not only content analysis, I learned, but also for things like diagnostic practices that doctors use, for example, to verify that you have a particular disease. So the basic point of it is, you know, you get two or more individuals to evaluate a set of cases, be they texts or diagnostic cases or whatever, and Recal basically computes a set of coefficients, in fact, that tells you the extent to which those individuals agreed while taking chance into account. It's actually the most cogent explanation I've ever given of Recal. Yes, I always tend to fumble over myself, so I'm very proud of myself for that. So I'm gonna really quickly just show it to you. I may be able to demonstrate it if I can. Oh, there's my cursor. Okay, so here goes. Let's hope this works. Okay, there it is. So here's the Recal front page. There's a number of different, couple different versions of it for your levels of measurement, whether you're looking at nominal, ordinal, interval, or ratio data, whether you have two coders only, three or more coders. Let's see. Okay, yeah, so we're up to 142,480 uses, which is great. Let's see here. I think I might be able to demo Recal 3. Let's take a look. So here it is. And if I browse, let's see if I can go and find some stuff. Actually, this isn't going to work, so I'm not using my own laptop. All right, so you can sort of imagine what the findings look like. This is actually a really great teaching tool that I primarily use for grad students. And the reason why I created Recal in the first place is because most existing statistical programs, shockingly, still do not provide effective implements to be able to calculate these particular coefficients. And so when I teach my graduate students content analysis, as I will when I teach the introductory methods class for the incoming PhD students this fall, they'll use Recal to calculate intercoder reliability coefficients when they do content analysis. And it's a really nice way of introducing them to a tool. And as one of the people, actually several of the people who have commented and thanked me for Recal have told me, a tool that allows content analysis to be a much more viable method, because typically when you do this and you submit it off to journals or whatever, they pretty much insist that you do the intercoder reliability calculations despite the erstwhile paucity of software to be able to calculate these things. So that was Recal. Unfortunately, I didn't get a chance to show you what the output looks like. Just imagine a bunch of coefficients on a web screen. Teaching tool two is also very interesting. These are a couple of things I created called T-Grab and FB-Grab. T-Grab is a really nice tool that I use when I'm teaching students how to analyze Twitter data. And it's great because, you know, you can... Actually, I think I might be able to demo this as long as it says, does this have Excel on it? Yes, it does. So, you know, a topic that's been in the news recently, unfortunately, is the terribleness unfolding in Ferguson, Missouri, where the police are doing some terrible things. And so for those of us who are interested in social movements and the power of Twitter to enable citizen reporting and politics, as I am, we can pull out some of this data for you. Cross your fingers, hope this works. Oh, that is very nice. So let's pull this down and take a look at this. Actually, I'm gonna open it, and we'll see if this works. And I don't know if this is something you can see. I should probably, let's see if I can pull this up. Zoom this in so that we can see this. We'll go 200%. Okay, so that's a little big, but you can see the data here, and you also note how quickly that occurred. And so this just pulled down 100 of the most recent tweets that mentioned the term Ferguson. And so this is not something that is really like a research, grade tool, but it's excellent for teaching students and getting their hands dirty, as it were, with Twitter data. You've got all the metadata that you would get if you had an industrial research grade data set of Twitter, but in a much smaller and much easier to collect form. And so this helps you do things like keyword analysis, very basic network analysis. Getting your hands on the data is very important. Unfortunately, there are very few tools that allow this to happen. But if we take a look at some of the metadata here, we've got the date that it was created at, the tweet ID, the name of the user who created it, the source, which is the app that was used to create the tweet, retweet count, the tweet text, and all of this. And so this is all here for you. So, when I hear tell of students saying, oh, well, I'm just taking screenshots of Twitter, it's like, no. This is how you do it, and this is how you deal with Twitter data sets of small to moderate size. And so I do make this available to students, and I use it to teach them how to analyze Twitter data at small scale, because typically the techniques that you use to do this analysis can be scaled up very easily, especially the more programmatic ones, such as keyword analysis, very basic automated textual analysis, and network analysis. So I'm actually not going to demo FB Grab because it works very similarly. So I'll just go ahead and move on from that. Teaching tool number three is the Python shell. I do a lot of my work in Python. This is something that is freely available to anyone who would like to download it from python.org. I just got back from a major disciplinary conference in my field, the Association of Educators in Journalism and Mass Communication Conference in Montreal, where I gave a workshop on Python. I had them all download this. And what they did was they created a script. Actually, the first script that they created was one that allowed them to produce a number of descriptive statistics about a data set that I provided to them. And here is a descriptive stats. You can see the number of tweets, number of columns of metadata, retweets, et cetera, on down the line. And so as a teaching tool, it's a really great environment that you can provide to people. It's free, which is great. So after the workshop, I told everybody, hey, you can take this in whatever direction you want. I emailed them some additional resources. I've sort of given you that, push into Python land that you can take in whatever direction that you would like to, and hopefully they will. It's always hard to tell how successful those things are, as it is whenever students leave your classroom, you never know what happens. But sometimes they come back and they tell you, wow, this was great, and look at where I went from that initial push that you gave me. So this is another one that I have used. I also used it with undergrads at AU last fall semester, and I look forward to using it again in the future. Okay, moving on. So I'm moving into the resources, right? So the tools, you do things with tools, kind of obvious. You use them to create things, you use them to do analysis. Resources are really more things that you read, analyze, study, and then you sort of internalize that information and apply it in various ways. And so this is one of the things I use when I teach Python. It's called a crib sheet. Also, I've referred to it as an online handout. Hopefully I have access. Oh yes, how nice. So this basically was something I gave to my undergrads last fall semester, as well as the participants at the AEJMC 2014 Python workshop. Has lots of very basic information about Python, so that if people were not paying attention as I was talking, which never happens, they could refer to this document and have that information at hand online, so no need to hand out actual physical handouts, in keeping with AU's green initiative and sort of general environmental consciousness. And so all this information is here. We divide it into concepts, a definition. You've got examples here, things you can paste directly into the shell and see how they work on your own on down the line. And when I give them their independent assignments and I'm sort of circulating around and trying to help them around the sort of annoying things that stop people from being able to learn programming properly, I can say, please refer to the crib sheet, look it up, try to figure out which function will allow you to get that outcome that you're looking for. And I modify this based on the different types of classes I teach. So when I taught my undergrads last fall, they had a whole semester of Python, whereas with AEGA, they only had 4 hours. So I can sort of pick and choose, make that larger or smaller, make different versions of it for those different groups. Okay, teaching resource number two. This is something that I created. I mean, hopefully this will come up. Sometimes it doesn't come up. This is, oh, wow. That is not found. Okay, well, let's try that. Well, it's definitely there last time I checked. So, you know what? Things were just going so well that I'm not sure why that did not pop up. But, maybe let's take out the slash here. Probably won't give me anything. No. Okay, so imagine a network map that is interactive in nature. You can kind of zoom in and out. It's a tool that I use to teach graduate students about the structure of the field of communication. Basically, it took a whole lot of data from Web of Knowledge, communication, journal articles, and based on co-citation, created network clusters that symbolize the most cited works within the different topical clusters of communication research, as well as identities of those. Let me see. Actually, I think I've got the blog post over here. Let's see if I can pull that up. So yeah, so I took it from these journals, a bunch of comm journals, probably in the back, you can't read those. Comm research, comm theory, political communication, et cetera. And then I was able to come up with these. There were 9 clusters, and so this is something that helps graduate students to see what the major focus areas of communication research are. Also, the data are based on the past 10 years, and so this is recent data. And so this helps them figure out where they're going to go, what they want to study, and critically, this is very important when they are trying to formulate the lists of texts that they're going to use for their qualifying exams, the specific texts that everyone in the field within that particular cluster is likely to know. The ones that are cited most, the ones that are discussed most, take some of the guesswork out of that. I know that when I was developing my qualifying exam materials, I was like, oh my gosh, there's so much stuff. What do I choose? What do I leave out? And so by looking at these items that everyone or most people in the field are going to know, they are able to make informed choices about the kinds of things that they integrate based on the ones that are going to have the most value because they've been cited the most. Really sorry I couldn't get that to work, but life goes on. Let's see. The final teaching resource I use is YouTube. Many also mentioned by Brian. All of you know about this. One of the ways I like to use YouTube is in my COM 100 classes, Introduction to Communication. I have students go to YouTube, find commercials that are specific examples of particular advertising techniques and fallacious reasoning, right? So bandwagon, plain folks. This was all stuff that came out in the Institute for Propaganda's book that came out in like the 30s or something. And so this is really great. It's like in the wild, so they have to go through and they say, okay, here's a commercial that really shows plain folks or appeal to authority or whatever it is, and here's why. And they email it to me, and if I decide that they have actually done this effectively, I give them a little bit of extra credit. And then the game show aspect is I show it in class, and then I have the class try to guess what it is because they send it to me in advance, and then I put it on a big screen. It's kind of fun and also gets them too excited about learning these wonderful concepts that were developed almost 100 years ago now. And of course, since YouTube has so many commercials on it, it's a really great resource for finding that stuff. Not too much in the realm of concluding remarks. So creating some of these tools requires coding knowledge. Fortunately, using them does not. If you're interested in using any of these, please talk to me and I can show you how to use them. I try to make them as user-friendly as possible, although as a pre-tenure faculty member, sometimes user design is not my like number one priority, but I can try to do these. So just getting it to work is really important. Again, this probably goes without saying, try to use tech where it's helpful, not for its own sake. Just as our students are, sometimes we can be very distracted by like very shiny objects. But just try to like think about whether this is something that actually is going to enhance your pedagogy and not just sort of be a shiny thing that you're using just because it's kind of shiny. And then, of course, the last one I would say is make sure your students know how to use the technology, because the instructional technologists in the room, of which I used to be one before I became a professor, will know that many times when people have technological problems, they won't tell you. So you have to sort of like go behind them and say, you're sort of like three steps behind, what's going on? And then they'll sort of do it if you sort of get in their face. And this is something that I have to do every time I teach programming, but it's cool, you know, because it's hard. But so don't be afraid to sort of, you know, get out there and make sure that students are actually doing this before the assignment is due, because then you'll find out and then they'll all fail and then everybody feels bad. But so make sure they're doing that, because some of them can be a little bit bashful in terms of communicating that. That's it. Happy to take questions about any of this stuff. Thank you for the award and for listening.
Make just one emendation to what you have said.
Sure.
You suggested that maybe we reverse the order in a way that anybody planning a rock concert would not. There are two rock stars from this concert. So I thank you both very, very much, because it's even Stephen in terms of how much you have shared with us and, at least on my part, inspired me in terms of where we can go forward.
Thanks.
Let me open things up to questions for either Dean or for Brian, whichever order you want to take them in. Oh, come on, Brian at least seeded a question with you. And Dean, you're welcome to as well.
You want to answer that question?
Myself wired. Where do I plug in the guitar? Online, what I like and don't like. Was that it?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's not going to show up on the screen, but I can still talk it. What I really like about it is no lousy classrooms. Years ago, there used to be somewhat inadequate classrooms at American University. You don't know about that now. But I'd go up in Hurst Hall, and I'd see the lines of sight be like, I'd have to look up, my students would have to look up here, or they'd have to, it was bad. And I'd always get these rooms, because I was just in that you know, totally sour spot. Not the sweet spot, but the sour spot in terms of classroom size. And then the AV would have a big purple, it doesn't happen anymore now, but it would have a big burned purple problem with it. You know what I'm talking about? No? It's gotten so much better. That's great. But there used to be sick AV. Classroom management, oh, shoes, but they don't put their hand in front of their mouth. And they're sitting there on the phone, and they're you know, and they're right under you. I mean, you're there lecturing at the, you know, and they're right there. And they're not taking notes. They're not looking at you. They're not listening. So I don't have to deal with those. That's kind of nice. And the flexibility of schedule and space, I don't have to worry about that. I do have a dependency on a learning management system that's getting just a little long in the tooth. What version of Blackboard do we have? Sorry. Shouldn't raise that. And on the internet, which...
Blackboard 14 is coming at Christmas.
Oh, and for Hanukkah?
It's really happening. Plus, we are trying out two other learning management systems that are being piloted as all possible.
Canvas and Excellent.
And it was Desire to Learn. But they renamed themselves. Anybody remember the new name?
I was at both of those things.
Yeah,
and That's great. Sorry. I gave we worked out this in advance, right? I just gave you the opportunity. I know some of the learning management systems don't always work with more mobile tech, although they're doing it more and more. iTunes U is there, and wow. I don't get as much exercise because I'm not running off to class. No, really, it's a problem. So I walk to and from work now these days. That was the first thing you saw there. And the 24/7 engagement, no, I set up my time map. So I have certain times I do things and other times when I don't. And Friday and Saturday nights, I'm going out. Oh, we're staying in, but we're doing something together. And the weekends are pretty much also for me and my girlfriend and my motorcycle and maybe my kids. So that little time management thing helps too. Thanks. What don't I like about the I'm sorry, that's what I was just listing. The learning management system reliance, sometimes the internet doesn't work. Yeah, yeah. I also miss interacting. I mean, this is such a treat for me to talk to y'all. The wonderfully synchronous interactive nature is great, because I kind of miss it. So, but I have opportunities for that. Thank you for providing another one. And I can record. I just speak to the computer as if I'm speaking to a class. And you know, after 38 years, it's real easy. Yeah, it's just, yeah. This is your 39 starting. Told you I geez up.
URL that showed up when you were doing your presentation, dfreeland.org.
Yes.
What is that all about? And is it something that we can go to and get some useful information from?
Yes. So this is actually something that I can also speak to. Dfreeland.org is something that I started when I was a graduate student. I figured, you know, I was sort of trying to be a little bit forward-looking about it. You know, this was right after I finished my master's thesis, and I was beginning a PhD program. And my thought was, okay, well, by the time I go out on the job market, I want this to sort of be high in the Google rankings, and sometimes that takes a while. So I'll just start it a couple years early, so it'll be sort of out there, and I'll have my real estate staked out by the time that I'm sort of out there. Going and people will Google me and they'll find it and they'll be like, oh, this guy's pretty cool. And so over time I realized that, you know, for the, you know, couple $100 I'm paying for this web hosting server every couple years, I have a really great resource to create learning and teaching and research tools for myself and for others, right? So because they're not used that heavily, I just write something up in PHP or Python, throw it out there and tell people about it, and they're like, great, you know, we can use this. So I've created some tools that are public, some that are private, and it's really just amazing to me that I have, you know, I'm sort of, you know, when I really think about it, I'm kind of blown away by it. I mean, I just sort of pay this amount of money and I have this platform to create all these things. And it's something that I guess it's sort of hard to encourage my students to do this because I haven't really been around long enough to have like my own acolytes who, you know, can sort of come up and do the you know, for lack of a better term, do the programming at a level that I do it. But, you know, eventually I would like to sort of advocate this as a more general strategy to say, have your own website, not only, you know, do blogging and sort of the typical things that people do with their own websites, but also use it as a resource for tools that you can create and host and share with others, because I've really found it to be an invaluable, thing for me, as well as, you know, my own little sort of place in cyberspace where I have my CV and other typical kind of professory website-y stuff. So.
So what can we as faculty get to go to your website? What could be of use to us on that?
Oh, well, you can use Recal for free. That's pretty cool, right? That's how I got to 124,000 whatever hits it was. There's also a tool that allows you to take, so if you've got existing Twitter data, you can convert it into a format that is useful for network analysis using a Google spreadsheet, which is pretty cool. I also have my full Python module that I use for network analysis. That's available there as well, and a couple other odds and ends. So there's some stuff there. Also, my communication map, if anybody's in communication or interested in just the structure of how you would map a discipline using network analysis, you can try that link again. I thought I had it right, but I may have had it a little bit wrong. I'll definitely check it again. I'll fix it if it's not right. And you can check that out and see how that could be applied to your own field, or if you're really interested in comm, you can sort of dive in and take a look at what's going on there. So yeah, there's a lot of stuff on there. So go there, check it out. Yeah, sure.
And a question.
I just wanted to ask, what are some of your predictions for the future? I mean, will we all be wearing Google or doing the Google Glass stuff next year this time, or what's beyond that?
You're closer.
Okay, I am closer, right? So, I subscribe to the maxim. I'm spacing on who said this, but, you know, the best way to predict the future is to create it. And so that's part of what I try to do through my website and through some of the other programming type things that I do. I hope to see a lot more programming used. I mean, certainly you've seen, you know, these initiatives that where there's sort of a back and forth between people who are discussing the merits of teaching every student how to code, right? You know, teaching people how, you know, in my own field of journalism and mass communication, you know, there's talk of data journalism and use of it for journalistic purposes in terms of research. There's data science and computational methods and big data and all that. And so I think that's one big thing that I'm trying to be a part of and trying to steer the course of within communication and possibly other disciplines. You know, I think mobile will probably be pretty big. Google Glass kind of scares me, which tells me I'm getting old. You know, I don't know. But, well, I guess I'll just leave it at that to say that, you know, I think programming will become more and more important to more disciplines. And I think that that within each discipline, there will need to be some people who know how to do it and how to teach it and how to evangelize about it.
Thank you for anticipating the last part of my talk, but I don't have the slides, but I'll spiel on it anyway. I had some pictures of not Google Glass, which I was very attracted to, but since it didn't work as well with my iPhone, and going Mac was one of my last midlife crises. I don't know what the other ones were. I won't discuss that right now. But I think there's better glasses out there. I think the tech will become more wearable and will become more immersed in it. We'll also gain more control over it. Have you heard about that do not disturb feature? It actually is a feature. It's not a joke. It's a feature you can invoke in your iPhone that says don't disturb, and you can during certain times. If you want to keep your phone on at night for some reason. But if somebody on your contact list or in your favorites list calls you twice, then it'll get through. That could be good. That gives you a little more control. I think there's more control over space and time that it can allow us. And the spaciest thing I can say that I had someplace in an early draft is that tech can enable us to transcend space and time. There's a good one to take away, right? But I think it's true in a way, to some degree. I mean, I don't have to always go to that classroom at that time anymore. I could be in Florence again, you know, teaching from there. I could. Maybe I will. That's kind of cool. I think there'll be more wearable tech, too, and it'll become greener. I mean, this takes about a tenth of what that MacBook Pro takes in terms of power, as I understand it. I think it'll get better and better that way. And I think students will continue to ask us for one-on-one interactions. I don't think that's going to ever go away, and I think that's good. But we'll also be able to take a lot of the burden of repeatedly doing the same thing over and over again, which is insane. I think it'll remove that, and that'll be very nice. It's already done that for all of us in some way.